Good morning. Welcome to Sunbury Baptist Church again. This is Pentecost Sunday, so welcome to a day when we celebrate the coming of the Holy Spirit nearly 2,000 years ago. And we celebrate that in faith, in our worship, in the expression of our love and adoration to God. So let's just commit our time this morning to Him. Father, we thank You for the Holy Spirit. Today we celebrate the gift that You gave all those years ago. The church was born. We celebrate that today. And we pray that we will not just live in the past or the past experience of the Holy Spirit, but live in the current relationship that we have with You by the Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit, we pray, into this gathering of Your people and across this city of Sunbury. Pour out Your Spirit in refreshing, in renewing, in bringing us into communion with the Father. We pray that in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's join in worship this morning as we sing 10,000 Reasons. Bless the Lord, O my soul.
Bless the Lord, O my soul. Oh, my soul. Worship His holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing Your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the
His holy name, sing like never.
prior to this COVID-19 period of restrictions and inability to gather people together, we would have had this week a prayer for Christian unity, which has been held in the Sunbury churches for some years now. And so at the initiative of Gavin Ward, Minister for St. Mary's, he gathered us as ministers together and said, let's pray for the churches. So we gathered on Zoom this week, and here is our prayer for the church.
Hello, everybody, from the Church of Sunbury, represented by all the ministers here from the churches in Sunbury. We represent the church on this week of prayer for Christian unity, and we'd like to greet you and lead us all in prayer. So I'm going to hand over to Kevin, who's going to start. Thanks, Kevin.
Thank you, Gavin. I'm Kevin McIntosh, the priest at the Catholic Church here in Sunbury, and this is great that we are joining in prayer. So let us pray. Forgiving God, set us free from the painful memories of the past that wound our shared Christian life. Lead us to reconciliation so that through the Holy Spirit we may overcome hatred with love, anger with gentleness, and suspicion with trust. We ask this in the name of your beloved Son, our brother Jesus. Amen.
Hello, I'm Andrew from the Salvation Army in Sunbury. It's a pleasure to be here with you. Let's pray. God, your word is a light to our steps, and without you we are lost and disoriented. Enlighten us so that through your word we may walk your path. May our churches crave your guiding, consoling, and transforming presence. Give us the honesty we need to recognize when we make it difficult for others to see your light, and the grace we need to share your light with others. We ask this in the name of your Son, who calls us his followers to be light to the world. Amen.
My name's Frank Rasenberger. I'm pastor of the Lutheran Church here in Sunbury, Bethany Lutheran Church, and it's wonderful for us at Bethany to be a part of the Sunbury Church that has a wonderful variety of faith expressions. Let's pray. Almighty God, our personal suffering, especially at this time during the last months of the coronavirus, leads us to cry out in pain, and we shrink in fear when we experience sickness, anxiety, or the death of loved ones. Teach us throughout all this to trust you, knowing that you bring good into all things. May the churches we belong to be signs of your providential care. Make us, Lord, true disciples of your Son, who taught us to listen to your word and to serve one another. So in confidence we ask this in the name of your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, and in the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Hi, my name is Paul Craig. I'm the pastor of Sunbury Baptist Church, bringing greetings to all the other churches which constitute the church in Sunbury. Let's pray. Loving God, your Son Jesus Christ broke bread, shared the cup with his friends on the eve of his passion. May we grow closer in communion. Following the example of Paul and the early Christians, give us strength to build bridges of compassion, solidarity, and harmony in the power of the Holy Spirit. We ask this in the name of your Son. We pray that your Holy Spirit might be poured out upon the church in Sunbury to empower us for mission and ministry in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
I'm Stan from St. Andrew's Uniting Church. Greetings to our brothers and sisters in the other streams of God's river of life flowing into the deep oceans of God's love. Would you pray with me? God of the orphan, the widow, the stranger, and the indigenous peoples of this land, instill in our hearts a deep sense of hospitality and reconciliation. Open our eyes and hearts when you ask us to feed you, to clothe you, to visit you, to respect you. May our churches participate in the ending of hunger, thirst, isolation, and marginalisation, and in overcoming barriers that prevent the welcome of all people. We ask this in the name of your Son, Jesus, who is present in the least of our sisters and brothers. Amen.
So let's come as a church family also to the Lord in prayer. I'm sure that many of you have relatives, friends, neighbours who have special needs, and I'd invite you to pray for them during this time. And as we pray for our missionaries at different times, I just want us to remember Maz and Esther today. Next week we might show you a video of their update, but just for now, to remember them. Let's come to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you for this day, a day to remember the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. We're reminded that without the Spirit of God, we wouldn't have life. Without the Spirit of God, we wouldn't have salvation. We wouldn't belong to Christ. We are born of the Spirit. We thank you for that, that in by faith in Jesus, through his death and resurrection, we have life in his name. And the Holy Spirit has revealed to us and makes known to us the Father. So, Father, we're just thankful for all that you do and all that you've done through your Spirit. We pray that you would touch those in need of healing. There are people today who are stressed mentally. There are people who are stressed physically and suffering, recovering from surgery, undergoing life-changing, life-giving surgeries, and their life hangs in the balance. We pray for all those, Father, who today are suffering physically. We pray for those, Father, under spiritual attack. I think of those, Father, who have made decisions in their lives that have led them down a path they'd rather not be right now. We pray for recovery. We pray that you would touch their lives and give them a fresh start, a new beginning, and faith would come into their lives. We pray for those, Father, that we know in our neighborhoods who really need a touch from you today. We thank you, Lord, for what's happening nationally as we see life beginning to flow again in our communities. We still continue to pray against the infection with COVID-19. Many folk are still grieving the loss of loved ones and have suffered through this time. And Father, we know that the danger is still there, but we ask you, Father, to protect our community, to protect our families, to help us through this time, to get to that place of immunity that we can then live in freedom. Father, for whatever you're teaching us through this time, we pray that we'll not lose it. And as a church family, as we think about ways to come back together and maybe do church differently, maybe things will never be quite the same, that we will embrace the change, we'll embrace the direction you're giving us, we'll embrace what you are doing in the life of this church as well as in the other churches around us and in Sunbury. Father, we lift up to you today every church in Sunbury. As the pastors have been praying for unity in the churches, Father, we pray for each church that its witness and its power and its ministry will not be ineffective, but be effective for the sake of the gospel. And we pray, Father God, that you'll watch over SBC as well, that through our life and ministries, that as we start again, as we begin or continue some of the ministries that have been meeting by Zoom and then begin to have face-to-face meetings, we just look to you, Father, and ask you to breathe life into the church. Today, as we think about your Holy Spirit coming into the lives of believers, coming into the life of the church, we just present to you our hearts, Lord. Write your laws on our hearts by your Spirit. Show us your principles for life and your principles of faith, that we might be people who walk with Jesus in the power of the Holy Spirit. Guide our thoughts and our meditations, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's go to another song. I think this might be a new one for SBC, but it's such a simple one, and the prayer that goes with this song is simply a prayer of invitation for the Holy Spirit to live in us and move in us. And I hope that can be our prayer as we listen to this song and join in singing, "Welcome, Holy Spirit."
let's hear some readings on this Pentecost Sunday. Does the wind ever stop blowing? And does it stop somewhere or just keep going around the world? There came a day when a wind began in a certain house that filled with a light like a flame. It roared justice. It came in with a rush of love. It whispered peace and compassion. And it carried words of hope and joy to a world so anxious and needy. It was gentle enough to touch the wounded soul and strong enough to stir seeking hearts. It pulled down walls of distrust and fear and opened wide doors of possibility. Hatred dissolved in its path and the deep pits of pain were filled in with its strength. It brought new life to a broken world. That wind blows still. It comes to restore, make new, heal, empower, refresh. Come, Holy Spirit. And from the Word of God, as we read the Passion Translation in Acts chapter 1, verses 1 to 9. To Theophilus, the lover of God, I write to you again, my dear friend, to give you further details about the life of our Lord Jesus and all the things that he did and taught. Just before he ascended into heaven, he left instructions for the apostles he had chosen by the Holy Spirit. After the sufferings of his cross, Jesus appeared alive many times to these same apostles over a 40-day period. Jesus proved to them with many convincing signs that he had been resurrected. During these encounters, he taught them the truths of God's kingdom realm and shared meals with them. Jesus instructed them, "Don't leave Jerusalem, but wait here until you receive the gift I told you about, the gift the Father has promised. For John baptized you in water, but in a few days from now, you will be baptized in the Holy Spirit." Every time they were gathered together, they asked Jesus, "Lord, is it time now for you to free Israel and restore our kingdom?" He answered, "The Father is the one who sets the fixed dates and the times of their fulfillment. You are not permitted to know the timing of all that he has prepared by his own authority. But I promise you this, the Holy Spirit will come upon you and you will be filled with power. And you will be my messengers to Jerusalem, throughout Judea, the distant provinces, even to the remotest places on earth." Right after he spoke these words, the disciples saw Jesus lifted into the sky and disappear into a cloud. As they started into the sky, watching Jesus ascend, two men in white robes suddenly appeared beside them. They told the startled disciples, "Galileans, why are you staring up into the sky? Jesus has been taken from you into heaven, but he will come back the same way you saw him ascend." And from chapter 2, verses 1 to 13. On the day Pentecost was being fulfilled, all the disciples were gathered in one place. Suddenly they heard the sound of a violent blast of wind rushing into the house from out of the heavenly realm. The roar of the wind was so overpowering, it was all anyone could bear. Then all at once, a pillar of fire appeared before their eyes. It separated into tongues of fire that engulfed each one of them. They were all filled and equipped with the Holy Spirit and were inspired to speak in tongues, empowered by the Spirit to speak in languages they had never learned. Now at that time there were Jewish worshippers who had emigrated from many different lands to live in Jerusalem. When the people of the city heard the roaring sound, crowds came running to where it was coming from, stunned over what was happening, because each one could hear the disciples speaking in his or her own language. Bewildered, they said to one another, "Aren't these all Galileans? So how is it that we hear them speaking in our own languages? We are northeastern Iranians, northwestern Iranians, Elamites, and those from Mesopotamia, Judea, East Central Turkey, the coastal areas of the Black Sea, Asia, North Central Turkey, Southern Turkey, Egypt, Libyans who are neighbours of Cyrene, visitors from all over the Roman Empire, both Jews and converts to Judaism, Cretans and Arabs. Yet we hear them speaking of God's mighty wonders in our own dialects. They all stood there dumbfounded and astonished, saying to one another, "What is this phenomenon?" But others poked fun of them and said, "They're just drunk on new wine."
Thanks for that reading, Dawn. Appreciate a poem and a couple of scriptures. We're going to be looking at the scriptures from Acts chapter 1 and chapter 2 as we go through the message this morning. Since Easter Sunday, April the 12th, for the last 7 weeks, we've been looking at the impact of the resurrection of Jesus on the people who walked with him to the cross and the grave, on the relationship made possible between God and man because of the work that Jesus Christ did on the cross. And all of this to ask us the question, if God has done all of this so that he can restore us to a place of communion with himself, what difference has it made to us? What impact has the resurrection of Jesus Christ made to our lives in relationship to God and also in experience of life? When Jesus rose from the dead, he appeared to Mary, Peter, Thomas, the disciples. In fact, Paul tells us he appeared to 500 people at various times during that 40 days of his life on earth post-resurrection and pre-ascension. And there were many then who witnessed to his death and his resurrection. Jesus had promised his disciples before his death that after he had returned to the Father, he would send the Holy Spirit from the Father. So after the resurrection, he again spoke about the coming of the Holy Spirit. In that reading we had in Acts chapter 1, very, very famous text that is quoted so often in respect to the purpose of the Holy Spirit and the mission of the church, Acts 1:8. "But you'll receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you'll be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth." In a previous verse, in verse 4, we read what Jesus told them to do, and this is the 120 believers who were gathering in the upper room for prayer. He had told them before he left, "Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized you with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit." So on the day of Pentecost, 33 AD, 120 disciples, and we're told this in chapter 1, 120 disciples of Jesus gathered together in a house, and suddenly there was a sound like a mighty rushing wind that filled the house, and it appeared like tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each person's head. Notice the descriptions here, like. This is something where it's a phenomenon you see in Revelation and in Daniel and in Ezekiel, where there's a description of a manifestation of God. It's often trying to use something familiar in order to describe something unfamiliar. So it was like a mighty rushing wind, and it was like tongues of fire. But there was one manifestation that wasn't like that. It was actually a work of the Holy Spirit, and that for the sake of those outside of this fellowship of 120 people, to at least get their attention and draw them to God. It says, "All the believers began to speak in another human language, not their own, but now in the presence of Jews and converts to Judaism from all over the Middle East and Asia Minor." The believers, the 120 who received the tongues of fire, who heard the mighty rushing wind of the Holy Spirit, began to speak in languages they hadn't learned before, enabled by the Holy Spirit, and it says, declaring the wonders of God. Each one heard their own language being spoken by these Galileans. And the response to that is that they were amazed, bewildered, and some dismissed it and said, "These people are drunk." It's interesting to note that when we looked at the resurrection of Jesus, there was a similar response. The amazement of the two on the road to Emmaus, the bewilderment of Peter and John as they stood at the empty tomb, and the dismissiveness of Thomas as he discounted the fact that it could have even been possible until he saw the evidence himself. So perhaps there's a lesson here for us. When God acts in a supernatural way, even if it's consistent with his character and promised in his word, the actual fulfillment of it sometimes catches us unaware. We're amazed or bewildered and can be inclined to be dismissive and dismiss what God is doing and put it down to human aberration. The outpouring of the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost, 33 AD, was a unique event in history. And this is something I just want to point out so that we don't try and recreate something that the Bible never meant us to. That precedent does not mean that we are going to see the same thing happen again. Although it never precludes what God can do. The first thing is, it was a fulfillment of prophecy. This is Peter's interpretation. And he quotes from Joel chapter 2, 28, I will pour out my spirit on all flesh, and your sons and daughters will prophesy. So Peter explains that what happened on the day of Pentecost in Jerusalem was actually a fulfillment of the prophecy of Joel many hundreds of years before that. So that's unique. This was a beginning event. This was something that took place at a particular time and place that's unrepeatable, because the Holy Spirit didn't go away and come back and go away and come back. He was given, as promised by the Father, given to the church, remained the indwelling Spirit in the lives of believers from that day, even up to this day. The second thing is, what's unique about this event, it was the beginning of the New Testament church. People who repented and baptized were promised that they would receive the Holy Spirit on that day. So the 120 went to 3,120. And from this time onwards, there's that sense of anticipation and proclamation that those who repent, turn from sin, believe in Jesus, will receive the promise of the Holy Spirit from the Father. The third thing that is probably unique in this situation is that there's a manifestation of the Holy Spirit where they heard what they considered to be, thought to be, like a mighty rushing wind and like tongues of fire separating and resting on the heads of each one. Now, let me say right up front, there's nothing to hinder God ever doing anything that he wants to do again, just because it happened once or because it happened early in the time of the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. Doesn't mean it can't happen again. There have been actually other phenomena that have been recorded in revival times of hearing a mighty wind in the place. So it's not excluded. But we need to understand that the description of these events on the day of Pentecost are not necessarily a prescription for every believer and every church from then on to repeat this particular event. Beginning of the Holy Spirit's presence and power was an empowerment, an anointing that would continue to the end of the age. An anointing, if you like, an empowerment to be witnesses. As we saw in Acts 1:8, you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you shall be my witnesses, Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. So the presence, the power, and the manifestation of the Holy Spirit in a believer's life and in the church have been, in my lifetime and in ministry, a source of bitter controversy often. Theological battles and relational battles have been fought over this area of the Holy Spirit in the life of the believer. Churches have divided. We're probably going back to the charismatic era when I speak of that. Friendships have ended. Leaders have been rejected. Hearts have been broken because of controversy about the way in which the Holy Spirit manifests in the life of a believer and in the life of the church. It's ironic, isn't it, that the Holy Spirit, who came to bring unity, who came to restore us to fellowship with the Father in the name of Jesus, and on the basis of the finished work of Christ on the cross, has been used in such a way that instead of seeing the fruit of love and joy and peace and patience and kindness and goodness and gentleness, humility and self-control, we've seen bitterness and anger and jealousy and strife. And you sort of have to think, don't you, that that's probably not a work of the Holy Spirit, talking about the Holy Spirit in those ways. So what can we expect? What is universal for us? What would the Holy Spirit do in every believer's life? Well, firstly, there's the new birth. I believe that the Bible teaches very clearly that if a person does not have the Holy Spirit, they do not belong to Christ. 1 Corinthians 12. In John chapter 3, Jesus said, you must be born again. Unless a man's born again, he cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. That which is born of the flesh is flesh. That which is born of the Spirit is spirit. You must be born again. So this birth process, this belonging to Christ, belonging, having salvation, being united to the Father, being becoming children, having the power to become children of God, which is promised in John 1 to those who receive Jesus. That comes true through the Holy Spirit. We are born of the Spirit, and therefore we have a relationship with God. There is no other way. I remember being sort of derided by someone as I began to share my faith a bit, and they had a religious background and said to me, "Oh, are you one of those born-again Christians?" And I guess I was a bit cheeky at the time. I said, are there any other kind? Because in a sense, from a biblical point of view, and I don't think that's just being smart, from a biblical point of view, if you're not born of the Spirit, you don't belong to Christ. You don't have the Spirit of God in you. So it's so important that we repent and believe that we're saved by grace through faith in Jesus, but that's a work of the Holy Spirit. The second thing is the Bible tells us that we're to be filled with the Holy Spirit. In Ephesians 5:18, do not be drunk with wine when it is debauchery, but be filled with the Holy Spirit. In fact, the Greek tense of the verb there literally means being filled with the Holy Spirit. Continue to be filled. And in fact, in the passages in chapter 5 and 6 of Ephesians that follow, Paul articulates what it means to be filled with the Holy Spirit. He says, be filled with the Holy Spirit, addressing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. And then he says, husbands, love your wives. Wives, be subject to your husbands. Children, obey your parents. Slaves, honor your masters. Then put on the whole armor of God. Pray at all times in the Spirit. So he actually gives a whole lot of instances or examples of what it means to be filled with the Holy Spirit. What's the outworking of being filled with the Holy Spirit? The third thing that I think is relevant to us and still a part of the work of the Holy Spirit taught in Scripture is that each one of us is given a spiritual gift. This is where the controversy came in the 70s, particularly in the charismatic movement, but was there from the beginning of last century, 1903, 1904, whatever, the Azusa Street Revival, and the beginning of the Pentecostal movement, with a manifestation of tongues as an evidence of the baptism of the Holy Spirit, there was a controversy that ran right through and then became broadened in the charismatic movement. But the Bible still teaches that the Holy Spirit gives as he wills, that he gives to each one a manifestation of the Spirit as he wills for the good of all. 1 Corinthians 14, Paul says, you seek the gifts of the Spirit. And he doesn't mean that you individually, although you're part of that, but it's actually in the Greek, you plural. In other words, as a church, as a body of Christ, to whom gifts are given, seek out, be anxious for, receive by faith. Be earnest about making happen in the life of the church those gifts that the Spirit has already given, that he gives by faith to those who believe in him and follow him. But he still gives as he wills. So it's not a matter of searching out whatever gift you want and going hard after it and getting it from God. It's actually about the church saying, Holy Spirit, empower us to be the body of Christ, to be the manifestation of your grace and mercy in us, the outworking of what you are doing in us that makes us the body of Christ, that knits us together, that we need each other. Paul in other places gives the example of the physical body. The eye can't say to the ear, I have no need of you, or the hand to the foot say, you know, what purpose do you serve? Each member of the body serves a particular thing and function within the body that makes it important and makes the body function as a whole. So the gifts of the Holy Spirit are as much for today as of any time since the beginning, since the day of Pentecost. The gifts and outworking of the Holy Spirit is as relevant today as it's ever been. Holy Spirit has never left the church. And if you study church history, you'll see that down through the ages, there has always been a witness to his presence and power. To people who understood that, Origen in about the 3rd century and others way right down through the history of the church have maintained a witness to the work of the Holy Spirit, even in the church's darkest hours of corruption and political power and apostasy. The Reformation brings a major correction to the church, restoring salvation by grace through faith. The whole justification by faith movement of the Reformation was to establish again on the foundation of the Word of God that people are saved by grace and not by works. And if we had time this morning, we could trace, and I'd need more research and more time to do this. I've heard some excellent expositions, and that's why I'm not prepared to take it on without really doing my homework. But I'm sure that many of you have heard of that sort of tracing down of history of the moves of God to restore the church to its glory and power through the Holy Spirit. We could talk about the restoration of the gifts of the Holy Spirit from the reformation of pastor and teacher to the evangelistic moves under the New England Reformation, Jonathan Edwards and of D.L. Moody and others, and obviously Billy Graham in the last century, to the re-establishment of apostleship through the modern missionary movement, and then also to establish and re-establish the gift of prophecy within the church, which has been controversial in some circles. But the Holy Spirit is dynamic. He's powerful. He's renewing. He's refreshing. And he is a person. The Holy Spirit is not just a commodity, and we talk about being poured out and being like fire and being like water and all of those things, but the Bible makes it very clear that the Holy Spirit is a person. He is the person of the Godhead. Where the Holy Spirit is not quenched by unbelief or grieved by unconfessed sin, he brings freedom to all who receive him and listen and obey his voice. It's too easy for us to become caught up in the theological traditions of the past. Like the Pharisees who interpreted the laws of God and then made their interpretations more authoritative than Scripture themselves, it's easy for us to get caught up in our own particular theological persuasion interpretations and then make that the authority by which we either argue the case for our own particular tradition and divide the church. But the Holy Spirit was given to the church as the presence and power of God with us to bring us into communion with the Father through the Son, through Jesus Christ. So any manifestation, any working, any gifting, any anointing, any baptism of the Spirit that does not draw us closer to the Father and therefore to others who are also in Christ, that brings us into communion with the Father and with his children, maybe a misuse of a genuine work of the Spirit, a genuine gift of the Spirit, or at worst, a counterfeit produced by the enemy to divide the church. Paul's teaching on the Holy Spirit came out of an encounter with Jesus on the road to Damascus. And the following baptism of the Holy Spirit, the laying on of hands by Ananias. He didn't build a theology around his experience, but his experience opened his heart and mind to understand what the Holy Spirit would show him from Scripture and reveal to him. And we have the same promise of the Holy Spirit, the same absolute need for the Holy Spirit to be a witness, to engage us in ministry, and to make us successful in mission. The same command we have today to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Jesus said the Father seeks those who worship him in spirit and truth. If you think about that little quote from Jesus, it summarizes the Trinity, doesn't it? That the Father is the one who is seeking those who worship him in spirit, a reference to the Holy Spirit, and in truth, Jesus said, I am the truth. So the question for us as we move forward together as a church, as we move to maturity in our own lives, is what impact will the resurrection of Jesus have in our lives? It will depend how much the same Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead is allowed to work in and through us. This is a time for us to reflect and to open our hearts again and to say that the Holy Spirit is welcome. Welcome in our lives and our hearts. If you've had an experience of the Holy Spirit, whether it involved speaking in tongues or prophesying or extreme joy or overwhelming sense of the presence of God, the holiness of God, where you couldn't speak or you couldn't move or whatever manifestation you had, God gives us those experiences because of his grace to us. It's not a manifestation for pride. It's not a manifestation to be imposed on others, because the Holy Spirit does what he wills. That's true. We've talked about birth. We've talked about being filled with the Holy Spirit, being empowered for ministry with the gifts of the Spirit. But let's be careful that we don't push the Holy Spirit into a box of our own making, whether it's Baptist, Pentecostal, charismatic, liturgical, whatever form that we sometimes take in our churches and the way in which you've experienced Christ. Let's be open to the sovereignty of the Holy Spirit. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. There's liberty, there's freedom to worship, there's empowerment to love, and there's service that takes place for the kingdom of God. These are the things God's looking for. If our experiences end up dividing us, they may be counterproductive. But if the Holy Spirit is allowed to have free access in our lives, where we seek to allow him to work through us in power and love, then the church will grow. And one of the evidences of that will be, firstly, that the fruit of the Spirit will multiply. There'll be love and joy and peace and patience and goodness and kindness, gentleness, humility and self-control. These are the works of the Holy Spirit to produce character in us, and then ultimately to bring us into communion with the Father. We might become more and more like Jesus. So I hope that this Pentecost day is a day when you can stop and reflect, where you can think about what God is doing in your life, even before we come back into some sort of gathered church, which could happen soon. But right now, where you are today, to sit in your living room where you're listening to this and say, Holy Spirit, you're welcome in this body, the temple of the Holy Spirit. I want to dedicate this body to you. I want to dedicate my mind to you. I want to dedicate my heart to you. I want to give the members of my body, my hands, my feet, my eyes, my ears, my whole body to you. Renew my spirit within me. Let's make this a time of prayer and reflection. We're going to close in a minute with a song, Eagle's Wings. And just talks about rising up on eagle's wings, which, if you know the path of an eagle or the way that eagles fly, they ride on the thermals. They spread their wings when they get to a certain place and they just ride the wind. If the wind doesn't come underneath their wings, they don't fly very well. It's very hard work and they can't go very far. And it's the same for us. As we spread our wings today in faith, by faith in God, in his promised Holy Spirit, let's soar on eagle's wings. Father, we thank you for your Holy Spirit. We thank you that there's never a day ever, not a day, not a moment of our lives when you don't know us intimately and so well. You know the cries of our hearts, you know the hunger and thirst of our lives for you. And you know, Father, when we turn away. You know when our hearts are cold. You know when our hearts, our faith is lukewarm. You know when spiritual things no longer interest us and we turn away. When we give in to temptation, when we sin, when we grieve the Holy Spirit, when our disobedience quenches the Holy Spirit. Lord, all these things are known to you. There's nothing hidden from your eyes. We come to you openly today to confess that we are in need of cleansing, the blood of Jesus, need of refreshing by the Holy Spirit, and in need of empowering by the gifting, by the anointing of your Holy Spirit in our lives. We pray for your church. We pray for Sunbury Baptist Church that we will not be ever caught up in a controversy that allows us to be divided from each other over controversy, over theology, when Jesus unites us, when the truth unites us. As someone said, there are many ways to lean and only one way to stand straight. We want to stand in your truth without arrogance, without pride. Stand in the truth and believe in the promise that you give more of your spirit to those who ask you. We give you thanks in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's sing that song together, Eagle's Wings.
Here I am longing for you.
So may God bless you and your family this week. I trust that as you've prayed and sought the Holy Spirit, that you will know the infilling of God's Spirit. Pray in faith, believe what he says, and let him take care of the manifestation in your life. If you want to spend some more time today, just as we close off, there's another song that I've chosen, that Dawn and I have chosen for you. And it's a song by C.C. Winans about the Holy Spirit. Beautiful song. I just encourage you to sit back, listen, and spend this time in prayer. Meditate on the Word of God and the promise of God that the Holy Spirit has given to those who repent and believe, those who ask the Father for the Spirit will receive more. And let the Holy Spirit wash over you. Take time today for a time of prayer and extended worship. God bless you.
Our soul.